Our next speaker is Manoj Mehta. He is a senior editor with Times of India. He is the author of the book When a Tree Shook on the 1984 anti-Sikh carnage. Manoj Mehta, please.
Thanks. Let me clarify that I'm no more with Times of India. I'm an independent journalist. Like Gauri was, and we were very old and dear friends, but probably nobody could have been as fearless as her. As Sanjay said a while ago, we as of now do not know the identity of the killers, but what we surely know is the identity of those who fostered this climate of hate, fear, and intolerance which facilitated her murder. We also know who have been openly and brazenly celebrating her murder and vilifying her even now. Yet, her brother, amid all this, is going out of his way, her brother Indrajit, is going out of his way to discount the possible complicity of Hindu right wing with whom she had repeatedly and valiantly fought for the most part of her career as a journalist and activist. On the other hand, her lawyer B.T. Venkatesh, who represented her in several defamation cases foisted on her by Hindu right wing, said in no uncertain terms that he believes that this was the doing of Hindu terror. And I gathered from social media that her sister Kavita has also said that she believes that this is about Hindutva forces and not about Maoists, as was being insinuated by her brother. Now, this dichotomy is because of this of a very public estrangement between Gauri and her brother Indrajit. Now, and this estrangement was not just personal but also political, and I'll have to go into a bit of background to explain why it is turning out the way it did in the last 2 days. Now, why is it that the brother is trying to push the investigation in the direction of Maoists and to get the case transferred to CBI, which is controlled by the central government? Now, for this, I have to go back to 2000 when her father, as Sanjay said, the legendary P. Lankesh, passed away, and subsequently, Gauri stepped in as the editor of Lankesh Patrika. Patrike, and her brother Indrajit took charge of the business side. And this arrangement went on for 5 years till in February there was a very major and public falling out triggered by an article relating to Maoists. Now, will you please? Yeah, the trigger was the alleged fake encounter of a Maoist leader, Saket Rajan, who she had known personally. Saket was her senior in Bangalore University and later here in Indian Institute of Mass Communications. Now, she wrote an article questioning the official narrative of the encounter, and as it happened, within a few days, there was a retaliatory strike by Maoists killing police men in the forest. And when she was about to when she was about to publish an article on that, a report, her account of the retaliatory violence, that was when her brother objected, her brother in his capacity as publisher objected to that publication, and then one thing led to another. They held press conferences and they filed cases against each other, and but then none of this faced Gauri displaying a great deal of resilience. Within a few weeks, she launched her own publication, which she named Gauri Lankesh Patrike, and she took charge of both the editorial and the business side of this new publication. And incidentally, it was launched by Tarun Tejpal, who was then the editor of Tehelka. And when she took charge of this new publication, there was no looking back after that. She wrote a series of articles relating to this need to engage with Maoists. But at this point, I'd like to clarify that this canard that is being spread about her being a Maoist sympathizer is completely misplaced, is unfair, because in her writings, it is very clear that she is equally opposed to left extremism as she was opposed to right extremism. It's just that her approach to left extremism was conciliatory, while given the nature of the beast, and her approach to right extremism was confrontational, because in her perception, they were all set to overrun the state of Karnataka, turn it into another Gujarat, laboratory of Hindutva, and so on. So when she came up with this new magazine, this new weekly, in the course of this avatar, Siddaramaiah took over in 2013, and a year later he set up a committee aimed at convincing Naxalites to give up violence and surrender or enter the mainstream. So though a delegation of BJP leaders from the, you know, accused her of being a Naxalite sympathizer and demanded her removal from the committee, Siddaramaiah rejected that demand. And his trust in her paid off, as within a month, Gauri played a key role in persuading two senior Maoists, Srimani Nagaraj and Noor Zulfikar, to come over ground. On December 8, 2014, at an official event attended by Gauri, these two Maoists undertook in writing that their struggle against social events would continue through democratic means. Now, these two erstwhile Maoists became Gauri's associates in her campaigns to champion the interests of minorities and lower castes and the poor. After this episode of December 2014, her major preoccupation has essentially been her campaigns against the Hindu right wing, and the range of her activities were very wide. One of them, for instance, was that she published books. One was a translation of the myth of the holy cow by D.N. Jha. Another was Rana Ayub's Gujarat Files. And in the run-up to the 2014, she, in her capacity as a convener of Karnataka Forum for Communal Harmony, she brought out a book against Modi. Now, she became the target of Hindutva ire due to such activities, and they were not limited to just writing. She was in her avatar as an activist. She went to the Western Ghats to fight against this Hindutva attempt to Hinduize a Sufi shrine called Baba Budangiri. And in the year 2010, she had a first-hand experience of the intolerance of her opponents when these Hindutva activists disrupted the speech that she was delivering at a literary festival in Shimoga. Though the topic of her speech was pretty innocuous, the media and democracy, they objected to her presence because of her anti-Hindutva activities. And then She was also engaged in a big way in promoting this festival of festival commemorating Tipu Sultan's syncretic policies. This was something which got the goat of Hindutva guys. And then after Una, she not only went to Una, she came back and came up with a similar campaign in Karnataka. She organized Udupi Chalo march in order to combat the Hindu citadel there, which was very heavily into issues like cow and denial of land to Dalits and so on. And one of the issues that really proved very sensitive and controversial was the stand that she took on the Lingayat community. She herself was a Lingayat, and so is Siddaramaiah, and so is the BJP leader Yedurappa. And they were, the divide was over whether Lingayats could truly be considered a Hindu caste. Her view was that Basavanna, the founder, was somebody who rebelled against the core principles of Hinduism, Vedas, caste, and Lingayat is no different from, say, Buddhism or Jainism. And it was a travesty of Basavanna's philosophy that it is now being treated as a caste of Hinduism. Now, this is a line that was completely contrary to the Hindutva approach to Lingayats. And as it happened, the other Lankesh Patrika, which was being run by her brother, took a position that was in favor of the BJP position on Lingayats. And in fact, on more than one occasion, Indrajit expressed admiration for Modi and BJP rule in the, at the center. And that approval of BJP extended to this issue of Lingayat. And the reason I mention this Lingayat is also because it links her death very directly to the death of Kalburgi, another great Lingayat scholar who was engaged with this very very controversial, sensitive subject. He was killed at a time when he was all set to come out with his material, with his book on why Lingayats are a distinct community. And Gauri, to her credit, and very typical of her, she took up this campaign for justice for Kalburgi in a big way. And she, in that context as well, took the line that Kalburgi was right, and she was being he was attacked because of its repercussions to this whole scheme of Hindu consolidation against minorities and lower castes and the poor and so on. So I guess I run out of time, but I hope I succeeded in giving you a flavor of the kind of ideological battles that she was engaged in Karnataka. Thank you.